On August 2, 1979, Dallas-based private detective William Deere received a phone call from an unknown number. He was reluctant to answer the phone, as he was almost sure it was going to be someone asking him to take on an investigation. He had just returned from dealing with an extortion case in Tokyo, and the idea of getting straight back into work didn't sound too appealing. Regardless, something compelled him to answer the phone. He puts the handset against his ear. "Hello?" he asks. The voice that returns is desperate and shaky, belonging to Texas surgeon Dr. Melvin Gross. "I need help. My nephew has disappeared." Gross's nephew was James Egbert III, a computer aficionado and sophomore at Michigan State University at the young age of 16. James, who went by his middle name Dallas, was a deeply troubled individual. The pressures that come with being a child prodigy, stacked on top of the freedom and opportunities college provide, seemed too much for Dallas to handle. After reluctantly meeting with Dallas's parents in Ohio, Deere decided to look into the disappearance. Deere quickly deduced that Dallas was most likely depressed and probably abusing drugs. Fearing the worst, Deere traveled to the Michigan State campus with haste, where he quickly gained access to Dallas's dorm room. Amongst Dallas's belongings, he found a concerning note. It read, "To whom it may concern, should my body be found, I wish it to be cremated." After questioning Dallas's colleagues, Deere confirmed his suspicions of Egbert's drug use and depression, but he also learned something else about Dallas. He played a game called Dungeons & Dragons, and he especially liked to play it in the steam tunnels beneath the university. For the sake of the case, Deere thought it would be helpful to play a game of D&D himself. After running a session, he came away shocked, noting how immersive it was and how it got your imagination racing. He began to form a theory, and much to the dismay of local law enforcement, he wasn't shy about sharing this theory with the media. Deere believed that Dallas, while playing D&D in the underground steam tunnels, lost his grip on reality and wandered through the labyrinthian complex under the impression that this was a real dungeon. This theory was not true at all, as Deere found Dallas in Morgan City, Louisiana a few weeks later. It turns out Dallas, unfortunately, tried to take his own life by wandering into the steam tunnels and attempting to overdose on a sedative. When he woke up, he fled to a series of friends' houses, where he eventually wound up in Louisiana. While there, he tried to take his own life again. Egbert would unfortunately succeed in taking his own life about a year later, in 1980. The truth was, Dallas's disappearance had nothing to do with the tabletop role-playing game he enjoyed in his spare time. But it was too late. The hysteria of the Egbert case had already swept the nation. Dungeons & Dragons would become demonized by activist groups, posing it as a threat to the safety of their children. It was noted as a particularly effective gateway into Satanism, and it soon became one of the leading punching bags of the Satanic Panic sweeping through America in the 80s. But what if I told you that, as tragic as Dallas Egbert's story is, it ended up helping Dungeons & Dragons become one of the most popular pastimes in America, even to this day. To fully explore the impact that the Satanic Panic had on Dungeons & Dragons, we'll have to examine the panic as a whole. You see, one of the biggest myths surrounding this period in D&D's history is that Dungeons & Dragons was the sole cause of the Satanic Panic, when in reality, paranoia around Satanism was bubbling to the surface before D&D was all that popular. Coming into the 80s, many Americans were paranoid about their safety and security. They were coming off of a couple of pretty rough recessions, and middle-class women were beginning to take on jobs at unprecedented rates. With both parents spending most of the day working, children were left to their own devices more so than ever before. Many parents were concerned with what their children were doing in their unsupervised free time. This whirlstorm of paranoia and uncertainty was fertile ground for sensationalism and fear-based reporting. Thanks to a little book released at the turn of the decade, many turned their paranoia to Satanism. Not even the beloved Smurfs were safe.
Smurfs has gone occultic.
Very much so.
Smurfs carry a homosexual connotation in that most of them are male.
Widespread sensationalism of Satanism, say that fast five times, really started to begin in 1980 with the release of the autobiography Michelle Remembers by Michelle Smith and her husband, Lawrence Pazder. The book details Smith's childhood abuse at the hands of a satanic cult. Many challenged the outlandish claims Smith put forth in the book, considering Michelle's husband, who at the time was her psychiatrist, used the controversial technique of recovered memory therapy, which allows patients to recall forgotten instances of abuse and trauma. Putting controversial psychiatric techniques aside, others refuted Smith's narrative based on non-corroborated evidence, as she claims in the book to have gone missing for nearly 3 months after being kidnapped by Satanists, but after third-party investigators visited Smith's hometown and interviewed childhood friends and teachers, they claim she was never absent for any lengthy period of time. Regardless, Smith's legitimacy didn't matter. The book had already done its damage. Fear about Satanism and its effects on children began to grip the continent. This paranoia was only confounded by the infamous McMartin preschool incident. In 1983, Manhattan Beach resident Judy Johnson accused preschool teacher Ray Buckley of sexually abusing her son. Buckley was arrested, and police sent out letters to 200 parents of McMartin students, asking parents to question their children on if they had witnessed or fallen victim to sexual assault at the school. Several hundred children were then interviewed by California-based Children's Institute International, which then resulted in a claim that 360 children had been abused at the school. Many were skeptical of the procedures the institute used to question the children, claiming that they were asking leading questions to get answers the prosecutors wanted to hear. Some children claimed that, on top of being abused, they saw witches fly over the school, were taken on hot air balloon rides, and were sometimes taken through underground tunnels beneath the school by being flushed down the toilet. There was even an instance where McMartin's lawyer presented a series of photos to a student and were asked to identify any abusers among the photos. The child scans the faces of the photos, and their eyes lock on one. Their finger points to the photo. That one, they say. They're looking at a photo of Chuck Norris. The investigation was quickly losing steam, but still, some parents insisted authorities take their children's claims seriously. A series of excavations underneath the school took place, and in every one, not a single secret tunnel was found. Regardless, this didn't stop Judy Johnson from insisting Buckley had abused her son. She claimed that she had seen Buckley fly before, and that he was a Satanist. The case captivated the nation. It proved to many that Satanism was running rampant throughout the country, and it was a threat to every child in America. Not only was it coming from schools and tabletop role-playing games, but also corporations. In 1980, the Minneapolis Tribune posted an article titled, "Rumor Giving Company Devil of a Dime," where it linked Procter & Gamble's logo, a man on the moon looking at 13 stars, to Satanist imagery. Procter & Gamble disputed these claims, stating that the 13 stars represented the 13 colonies, but the damage had already been done. Between June and July of 1982, Procter & Gamble fielded 15,000 calls concerning their Satanist logo. They tackled the accusations with an aggressive media campaign and multiple lawsuits against the accusers. The flames were already too big to fan, though, and in 1985, Procter & Gamble announced they were retiring the logo indefinitely, which only sparked more outrage. No one was safe from the Satanic Panic, from preschool teachers to megacorporations. We can see then how the young but explosive Dungeons & Dragons quickly gained the ire of the satanic paranoia sweeping the nation. The game wasn't even 10 years old yet, but it had quickly captivated nerds and war gamers all throughout the country. Egbert's case certainly brought negative attention upon the role-playing game, but that was merely the kindling for the fire that was to come. Trouble really started for D&D in 1982, when high school student Irving Pulling tragically took his own life. Irving's mother, Patricia Pulling, blamed his suicide on Dungeons & Dragons, and she began an organization called BAD, which stands for Bothered About Dungeons & Dragons. 6 months after the death of Pulling, Mazes & Monsters released. Starring a young Tom Hanks, Mazes & Monsters is a dramatized version of the events in the Egbert case. The film was panned commercially and critically.
You can't! It's a trap! I have spells.
But this whirlstorm of events set up Dungeons & Dragons to be a primary target in the ongoing war on Satanism. Over the next few years, a litany of murders and suicides were linked to Dungeons & Dragons. Prosecutors claimed that the game brought out violent tendencies in its players, and that the game was so immersive that it rendered the players unable to separate fiction from reality. In fact, this was used in the defense of Darren Lee Molitor, a St. Louis resident who strangled 18-year-old Mary Toey in 1984. Molitor claimed that he didn't have a proper defense because he wasn't able to bring in experts to testify about the effects that Dungeons & Dragons had on one's mind, which Molitor was an avid player of. On trial, Molitor stated, "The reason I brought the game into the defense was not the evil aspect of it, but the way the game is played, the mind use. There is proof and evidence, in fact, that anything done within the aspect of role-playing is effective and dangerous." Molitor claimed that when he strangled Mary Toey, he was simply playing with her mind and had no intention of killing her. This did not hold any water in court, and Molitor was sentenced to life in prison. Perhaps the pinnacle of D&D's time in the Satanic Panic spotlight came in 1985, when co-creator of D&D, Gary Gygax, was featured on a segment of 60 Minutes speaking about the game and its effects upon its players. Bad director Patricia Pulling was also interviewed, along with psychiatrist and founder of National Coalition on Television Violence, Dr. Thomas Radecki. All three individuals were interviewed separately, but their interviews are intertwined together over the course of the program. It's obvious from the outset that 60 Minutes plants themselves in the anti-D&D camp, or at least the D&D is responsible for an increase in teen suicide and violence camp.
I don't think anyone is suggesting that your intentions originally with this game were anything but good. It was a game to have some fun. But in the light of what some people would consider to be strong evidence, don't you really think that you have to rethink your position about the game and at least make known the potential for abuse of the game?
Well, I again have to...
In the interview, Dr. Radecki claimed that 27 deaths had been linked to Dungeons & Dragons in the past 5 years. Radecki states, "These deaths are not coincidence. Not when you have careful documentation, not when you have notes, not when you have eyewitnesses." Radecki claims he consulted on a case where parents witnessed their child summon a Dungeons & Dragons demon into their room before taking their own life. Gygax defends himself by using an analogy, asking, "Who is bankrupted by losing a game of Monopoly? Nobody, because it's all make-believe." Pulling retorts, "It's not like Monopoly. There is no board. It is role-playing, which is typically used for behavior modification." At this point, we were half a decade past the Egbert case. Dungeons & Dragons had endured over 5 years of public scrutiny, and here was the apex. A dismantlement on one of the most popular news shows in America. Surely this spelled the ending for the fledgling game, right? Well, let's not answer that question right now, and instead, jump ahead a few years. It's 1995. It's been 5 years since the McMartin preschool trials ended, and not a single defendant was convicted of the 321 counts of sexual abuse brought against them. You see, halfway through the trial, it was discovered that Judy Johnson, the woman who brought forth the first allegations against McMartin Preschool, had been previously diagnosed and hospitalized for acute schizophrenia. She was found dead in her home in 1986 from chronic alcoholism. After two unsuccessful trials, Ray Buckley was dismissed from court on July 7, 1990. He had been jailed for 5 years over a crime he didn't commit. Procter & Gamble have reinstated their old logo, and they're busy counting the cool $19 million they just won from a lawsuit against the individuals who accused them of hiding Satanist messaging within their logo. Dr. Thomas Radecki had his medical license revoked in 1992 after it was found that he was engaging in inappropriate activities with his patients. It would later go on to be discovered that he was trading opioids for sexual favors from clients. In 2023, he's beginning the fifth year of his minimum 11-year prison sentence. Bad or bothered about Dungeons & Dragons exists no longer, thanks in large part to the Pulling Report by author and game designer Michael Stackpole. Stackpole exposes Pulling in the paper as dishonest and unethical, as she claimed to have been a private investigator since 1981, when she only received her license in 1987. He goes on to poke holes in the logic and reasoning of pamphlets that the organization circulated to police departments, as well as pointing out her general ignorance on the subject of role-playing games. Specific arguments made against Pulling come in the form of her constantly warning against the dangers of players being familiar with the Necronomicon, as if it were some sort of satanic Bible and not a fictional book made up by H.P. Lovecraft. Pulling also left out details about her own son's tragic suicide. Seemingly interested in positioning D&D as the sole reason for his suicide, she would claim in the aforementioned 60 Minutes interview he was well-adjusted. But in that same interview, Pulling's daughter would break down crying, claiming that before Lee's death, he had threatened to kill her. Now, I don't mean to speak ill of the dead, but that doesn't sound well-adjusted to me. Lee's classmates and teachers also saw warning signs in the young boy, as one of Lee's classmates states in a Washington Post article, he had a lot of problems outside of the game. There were also reports of animal abuse at the hands of Lee in the weeks leading up to his death. Of course, when Patricia Pulling would circulate articles about her son's death at bad seminars, she would conveniently clip much of the reporting about her son's mental state out of the pamphlets. Stackpole points out that cutting facts out of an article and then circulating them to others falls under the category of directly editing copyrighted work, which is illegal. In a Style Weekly article written in 1988, Patricia Pulling said she conservatively estimated that 8% of the population in the Richmond, Virginia area were involved in some sort of devil worship. After being questioned by this, she went on to justify her estimation by saying that 4% of teenagers in the area and 4% of the adults in the area were devil worshippers, and that adds to 8%. The Pulling report was published in 1990, and Patricia Pulling would withdraw from the organization before the year was through. 1 year later, a joint report examining tabletop role-playing would be published by the American Association of Suicidology, the U.S. Center for Disease Control, and Health and Welfare Canada. The paper concludes that there is no link between fantasy role-playing games and suicide. And how badly did this whole affair hurt Dungeons & Dragons? Not at all. In fact, there's strong evidence that this period actually helped the role-playing game. This chart shows the sales of the game soared between 1981 and 83, right when the reporting on the Egbert and Pulling cases were at their peak. Fast forward to today, and the hobby's more popular than ever. And that was really the root of the issue, wasn't it? Let's look past the paranoia, the sensationalism, the manipulated narratives, and everything else, and focus on what really was the core issue with the anti-D&D camp. You can't dismantle an entire hobby. D&D was in the unique position of being the first widely published and available role-playing game, and while all the vernacular around the Satanic Panic focused on the idea of Dungeons & Dragons possessing some innate evil, in reality, people like Pulling and Rydecki were going after the role-playing hobby as a whole, and that never works well. Before tabletop, people said rock and roll was ruining their kids. That didn't stop Elvis and the Beatles from becoming megastars. In the modern day, some argue that video games cause violence. That doesn't stop the industry from soaring to new heights year after year, and I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the fact that some of the best-selling video games of all time were also some of the most controversial. What Pulling and the rest of the anti-D&D camp didn't realize is that they were becoming some of the biggest advocates for the game. Pulling would go on national television, ranting about how easy it is for someone to lose themselves in a character, cautioning how real game worlds would feel, getting to the points where players were unable to distinguish myth from reality. She warned against the dangers of playing a wizard or mage, as it would give the player access to real-world spells and curses. This scared the hell out of individuals susceptible to the paranoia of the time. But others who saw the sensationalism and paranoia for what it was, like a young kid with loads of free time and an active imagination, doesn't Pulling make it sound like one of the best things in the world? I think so. And so did the millions of players that discovered the game in the 80s and continue to play to this day. Thanks for watching.